Tonight, I'm very excited because, as I was recovering in the hospital, I had a sweet surprise given to me. I people always love to give me books while I'm laying in the bed, you know, recovering from cancer surgery. The biggest treat of all, I'll tell you, the biggest treat of all was Corey Taylor's new book, A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to Heaven, or How I Made Peace with the Paranormal and Stigmatized Zealots and Cynics in the Process. For those of you who don't know who Corey Taylor is, come on. I mean, one of the loudest, angriest, most kick-ass bands to come along in a long time, Slipknot. And most frightening, by the way. His brand new book, man, I'll tell you, I recommend it for every Ground Zero listener who wants to cut through the BS about the paranormal and understand that it's something more. And Corey has that captured in his book, okay? He has it captured in his book so well that this guy needs a TV show. I mean, really. Because the guy pulls no punches in his book. He actually deals with the paranormal the way I could deal. I wish I could deal with it most of the time. But see, I'm older now. I've had my ass kicked by many a demon and many a ghost in my investigations. And believe me, Corey has too. Let's bring him on the program tonight. Corey Taylor, welcome to Ground Zero.
How are you, man? What's going on?
I'm doing great, Cod. I'll tell you, man, when they cut into my body because I had the cancer on the kidney and they said, you could be reading Corey Taylor's book, I'm thinking, this is going to be amazing. And I was so, so happily surprised at your no BS way of going about talking about the paranormal. Is this something that you want everybody else to do? Because, I mean, I could take some lessons from you, and I've been doing this for 18 years.
Well, first of all, I appreciate that, man. I wish you luck in the recovery. It's good to talk to you. You know, for me, this was kind of more about, you know, trying to figure out what I thought these things were, you know, because, and I even said in the book, I'm like, you know, I just all the answers that are out there, I was never satisfied with them.
Right.
You know, I mean, whether it was the religious bent or, you know, the kind of preternatural side of things, or, you know, just, and then the other side of the fence, which is the skeptics just kind of dismissing it as whatever. I kind of been hopping around on both feet trying to figure out, you know, what this is, especially for, you know, from an atheist point of view, to be honest. And so I tried to come at it from a completely unique point of view. And, you know, I tried to, you know, look at it scientifically and really try to understand what this energy could be. And, you know, I was able to really kind of get a grasp on it, you know, just by like all the research I did and really tried to figure it out. So if it helps other people, you know, kind of get a grasp on it who don't buy the answers that are available as well, then, you know, so be it. But this was, honestly, this was more for my own gratification. But, you know, if other people get it, then that's really good.
I know that a lot of people are thinking that the way you took a stand about religion and the paranormal and everything else may get you some controversy. I found it a breath of fresh air because one of my biggest frustrations is while I have, being a person who believes in God, okay, I have the respect of people who have that God thing. But one of the problems I have and one of the things I found is that when you're dealing with the paranormal, you're not always dealing in a godlike realm. I mean, this is far from the God thing. This is something that I think has been unleashed and is out of the control of God in some respects, that it's in the control of the minds of humans, and it's also in control of what I would call the electromagnetic energies that surround us. And so to always say that, you know, you're going to raise your hand in the name of Jesus and call all this out, I think is nonsense. And I thought it was very brilliant of you to put that in perspective. But you did so in a way that didn't piss me off, nor would I think it would piss off a lot of Christians. I think they would see it as a person. Well, look, the guy's an atheist. He's agnostic. He doesn't know. But one thing he does have is respect for the paranormal, because this stuff has been bothering him for a long time, and he's had the experience, you know, working, you talk about the cold house, you talk about the mansions there in Laurel Canyon, which I had a friend of mine who was involved with Rockstar Supernova, which is that show that they did on CBS.
Oh, yeah, I remember that.
And apparently, Storm Large is this woman that I know that was on that show, and she said she stayed at one of those mansions that you were talking about there. Boy, she said that she heard breathing, she had something sitting on her chest, you know, and apparently, you know, and you had that experience with the shower. Tell us a little bit about that experience in those Laurel Canyon mansions.
Yeah, the mansion was where we recorded Volume 3, the Subliminal Verses, which was Slipknot's third album. And we were there hardcore for about 6 months. And from day one, it was very apparent that there was some weirdness going on there. You know, I had something walk through me the first day, and I was like, oh, good. This is going to be awkward,
right?
You know? So, but I had various experiences from, the temperature in my room going from sweltering hot to severely cold. I saw a man walk through the room when there was nobody else in the room with me, through a locked door, by the way. And that's the tuxedo man that I mentioned in the book. Mm-hmm. I had the blankets yanked off me. I heard crazy music coming out of the closet that was right behind me, where there were no electrical outlets. I mean, there was no way for music to be coming out of there. I talked about this in the book, that there were two digital clocks in my room set to different times, because I never used them, you know, like I never used those clocks. I had my phone with me, so I used that for the time.
Right.
And I never set the alarms on those things, let alone used them. And one night they both went off at the exact same time, even though they were set to completely different times. And I mean, you want to talk about just being pissed off that something's messing with you.
Right.
I was like, are you really? Really? Okay. It's, I don't even know what time it is. Like, none of these clocks are right. So, yeah, I mean, I'm stumbling out of bed. I can't see. I'm stubbing my toes, all because some ghosts wanted to mess with me, you know? So it was a raucous time in that place. And I look back on it fondly, but at the time, man, it was very stressful.
Well, I know that you had to you had to recollect some of these experiences, and I know that you were in contact with the other band member, Clown, and he too was talking with you about the experiences there. Was it hard for him to go back and talk about it without getting a little chilled?
Oh no, he loves that stuff. I mean, he's just like me, you know. Like, I mean, he doesn't go as in depth as I do, but you know, I mean, we shared a room that whole time,
right.
And he reminded me of something that I completely forgot about. He had gotten up in the middle of the night to go to the bathroom, and to get to the bathroom from his room, he had to walk through my room. And so he's walking through, and I was in bed by myself, and he said to me, he's like, I looked in the bed and you were covered, like it looked like you were covered in beings moving around and whatnot. And then he turned on the bathroom light, and it was just me laying in the bed. Like, it was, and that really kind of was like, oh God, that's not cool, you know. So
that would give me chills,
like,
for
that'll
sure.
Make you pucker up in the wrong places, you know.
Exactly right. Cause it all to pinch together. You have to really, what is that, a tight cheek night is what we call those things in the paranormal.
Exactly, yeah.
Do you think that maybe that has something to do with the fact that you're being singled out as one being followed by the supernatural because of the fact that Slipknot is such a nightmarish looking band?
That's a good theory. You know, the evidence would certainly support it if I put too much thought into it.
I remember when I first saw you guys, I was like thinking, this is, I mean, look, I used to go to Kiss concerts. Slipknot concerts are amazing, too. I've been to one. I'm just saying, you go from Kiss to Slipknot, and you're like going, this is the thing. This is it, man. This is the horrific stat. You know, Alice
Thanks,
Cooper
man.
Be damned. It's Slipknot now, baby.
Well, I tell you what, man. I mean, the thing that I've noticed is that these spirits, these bundles of energy, if you will, are definitely attracted to certain types of people, you know, and maybe it's people with like an overt sense of personality, like a strong sense of personality, and maybe that's kind of reflected in the energy that they give off,
right?
You know, I'm not talking from like whatever you call it, an aura or whatever. I'm not talking from like a cold reader or a medium standpoint. I'm talking about the actual energy that we all give off in waves, you know, because we are essentially 9-volt batteries, like they talked about in the Matrix. We give off serious waves of energy,
yes.
You know, and I think these bundles of energy get stirred up and they get gnarly when they find these not same souls, but souls that they become attracted to. You know, I mean, we see it with humans all the time with, you know, when it comes to soulmates and whatnot.
Well, see, I've always thought to myself that most spirits and entities, because, you know, I've had experiences much like you have. In fact, you even talk about physical confrontations with them, and I want to get into that in just a bit. But I think that most of the time these spirits have a message they want to convey, whatever they may be. And,
I think that's part of the personality
right.
being left over
right.
on that spirit, you know, and they're trying to find their place.
Right. And they're trying to find
world.
Someone who can best transmit it, you know. And,
yeah,
and so they
exactly.
go after people, as you say, with personalities that are strong like yours or mine or anyone else's. And certain people can't get into like ghost hunts and go, oh, I've had the experience, because it just doesn't attract to them. But then again, there are other people like you, of course, you know, in your book, you've had these things happen to you. And the thing is, you're an atheist. OK. And so this is also something, but you're basically conveying it in a way that won't get, I guess you could say, tangled up in all of the, you know, spirituality, religious, and you know, all this other stuff. But he can get into the more matter of fact, saying, look, if it can happen to me, it can happen to anyone. And you don't necessarily have to believe in an afterlife to see that this is happening.
Exactly. You know, and I came up with a fairly interesting idea, which I called the intelligent energy theory. Well, not theory, but hypothesis. And where, you know, where a strong enough personality can emboss that intellect, can emboss that personality onto their own soul. And, you know, once the body dies, that soul can kind of carry on, you know. Mm-hmm. And the thing that I discovered in all the research I was doing is that people are doing fairly similar research into encoding information onto light, onto energy. So I know that, you know, the people are looking into this as a very viable resource, and it's very fascinating. So I'm like, well, if that can happen over here, why couldn't that happen over here? You know?
Right.
And that really got me excited about it. I was like, well, man, maybe this has a basis in reality for that. And that really got me excited.
Well, this would indicate too why things like EVP happen, you know, and you've heard EVP, electronic voice phenomena. That stuff is fascinating, especially you being in the recording industry, know that, you know, while everybody else says, oh, this can be faked easily. Well, not really, not anymore. Not as we're doing, you know, you're doing digital recording and you still can pick up on this stuff.
Yeah, exactly. And I've been, you know, I've witnessed a lot of things where, you know, I've been in a room by myself, or I've been in a room with another person. And I mean, it's that thick kind of quiet, mm-hmm. you know, where, I mean, you feel like you've got your hands over your ears. It's so quiet, you know. And then when somebody actually says something, it scares the crap out of you. You know, that kind of quiet. I've been in rooms like with that kind of suffocating quiet doing EVP work. And then, you know, whether it's the next day or, you know, a few hours later, you go back and listen to it, and there's clearly something speaking in the background. And, it'll make the cackles raise up on the back of your neck.
You can also prove that when you're having the conversations, that you can ask a question and they will answer the question. So, skeptics come in and say, well, that could be that you heard what you wanted to hear. You saw what you wanted to see. That's not true. I mean,
it's not true at all, man.
No.
I don't want to hear this stuff.
No.
I don't want to feel this stuff.
No. So, speaking of Slipknot, any plans for a new album coming soon? I know that I'm sure everybody's waiting for something.
Yeah, we are. The plan is right now to reconvene next year and basically start throwing new music at each other. You know, just start throwing demos and whatnot together and see what happens. We have no timetable. We have no deadline. We're not going to put a period at the end of the sentence yet. But it's just starting to feel like it's time. So. Next year, I'm not really sure when, probably at the beginning of the year, we're going to start getting together and seeing what we can do as far as a new Slipknot album goes.
God, I think everybody's going to be, waiting for that and excited for that. I'm excited for that. Corey, gosh, I tell you, great time on the air with you tonight. And thank you so much for your book. I mean, I'm going to keep reading it. I'm still in the middle of it right now. Just excited for the book, excited for your success. All the best for Slipknot and all the best for you and everyone else involved. Thank you so much for being on the program tonight.
Thanks for having me, man, and good luck with everything. I know you've been through some hell, so I wish you luck, and if there's anything I can ever do, man, just let me know.
Well, we'd love to have you back on the program. You're a fantastic person, and we love you. Thank you so much, Corey.
I'd do my best, man. No worries. Thank you. Take care.
Man. Bye-bye. Corey Taylor, we thank him so much for being on the program. Remember, the book is called A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to Heaven, and I will read the subtitle here, or How I Made Peace with the Paranormal and Stigmatized Zealots and Cynics in the Process. Coming up, more of your views on...